So brothers and sisters, open up your Bibles to the book of Psalms. Psalm chapter 118. Psalm 118. So for those who are joining us for the first time today, this is the fifth and final part of a series we've been doing in the book of Psalms. We've looked at five of the Psalms more in depth. The last three Psalms we've looked at, which was Psalm 5, 32 and 55, these are Psalms of David, and we've seen that from the Psalms, there actually are some of the harshest words in the Bible. Some of the harshest and most difficult words to stomach are found in the Psalms, and they're what's called imprecatory Psalms. They're basically relating to David's enemies and the consequences that David suffered after his sin with Bathsheba. This is what the majority of David's Psalms are about. The psalm we're looking at today, 118, is a different type of psalm. It's called a messianic psalm. In other words, it has to do with the coming of the Messiah. Now, the author of this psalm is unknown. Some say it is David, and that probably is the likely case. However, it is unknown, and we can't be too dogmatic about who the author is here. But some say it is possibly David. Psalm 118 here is known as the Hallel. Hallel. Hallel means praise. Hallelujah. That literally means praise the Lord. Hallel. And now the Hallel actually comprises of Psalms 113 through to 118. So that is the full Hallel, 113 to 118. And you could say that 118 is like the climax of the Hallel. So the Hallel is a song which is sung twice a year. It is sung at the Feast of Passover and the Feast of Tabernacles. That is when the Hallel, including Psalm 118, is traditionally sung. Passover, of course, being about the sacrifice fulfilled at the cross of Jesus, and the Feast of Tabernacles, of course, which is a autumn feast, which we're coming up to very soon. We'll have more teaching about that. The Feast of Tabernacles relates to the millennial reign of the Messiah and the kingdom of God coming to earth. That is what the Feast of Tabernacles has to do with. Passover is the first of these feasts, and Tabernacles is the last of these feasts. So the first feast and the last feast is traditional to sing this Hallel, which climaxes in Psalm 118. Now, when the pilgrims would come from all over the Middle East and all over Israel to come and celebrate these feasts at Jerusalem, when these pilgrims would arrive, they would enter Jerusalem through the East Gate. On the east side of Jerusalem, we've got what's called the East Gate, and it is actually bricked up to this day. It's been bricked up for the last 500 years. But it's through the East Gate that the pilgrims would enter when they come to Jerusalem to celebrate these feasts. And the East Gate, of course, is where the Temple Mount still stands to this day. It is where the temple would have stood in the time of the Old Testament. And through the East Gate, it is where, of course, Jesus entered through the East Gate on the donkey in fulfillment of the prophecy in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. And of course, whilst the pilgrims would enter the East Gate to come and celebrate these feasts, they would be singing the Hallel, which climaxes in Psalm 118. Now, it's sung at both these feasts. However, there is a difference in that in Passover, they would sing it with their hands in the air. They would sing it with their hands in the air like this. However, at the Feast of Tabernacles, they would sing it waving palm branches. You've all seen the Jews at the Western Wall at Feast of Tabernacles waving these palm branches around. Yeah, they're called lulavim in Hebrew. Lulavim, they're palm branches. And they stand there at the Western Wall still to this day, waving these palm branches with a lemon in the other hand, celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles. Well, that is how it's celebrated, and they will do that while singing this psalm. So they're the two main differences. In Passover is sung with hands in the air, and at the Feast of Tabernacles, it's waving palm branches, which is an instruction we see from Leviticus 23, verse 40. So let us go into Psalm 118 from verse 1. Hopefully everybody's found it okay. Psalm 118, verse 1. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. We've just sung at the beginning of this service that his love endures forever, and also his mercy endures forever as well. Verse 2, let Israel now say, his mercy endures forever. Let the house of Aaron now say, his mercy endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord now say, his mercy endures forever. This is what they would have been singing in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 when King Jehoshaphat was leading the Israelites into battle. They were singing, his mercy endures forever. This is where it was taken from. And of course, isn't it nice to know that God's wrath doesn't endure forever. God's wrath is only for a time, according to Isaiah 10, verse 25. God's wrath will not endure forever, but his mercy and his love will endure forever. Isn't that comfort to know, brothers and sisters? Hallelujah. Verse 5. I called on the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? What can man do to me? Remember what Jesus said in Luke 12, in verse 4. He said, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body, and after that, have no more that they can do. But I will show you who you should fear. Fear him who, after he has killed, has the power to cast into hell. Yes, I say, fear him. So isn't it also a comfort to know that man cannot do anything to us except kill the body? That's all they can do. God is the one we should fear, who can not just destroy the body, but also the soul in hell. Verse 7. The Lord is for me among those who help me. Therefore, I shall see my desire on those who hate me. Now, this is from the New King James Version, and this isn't actually the best way that this is translated. Therefore, I shall see my desire. If you notice in the New King James, the word desire is in italics, and that means it has been added. It means it's not actually in the original Hebrew. The better way to translate this would be, I will look upon with triumph those who hate me. That would be the better way to translate this. I will look upon with triumph those who hate me. And again, this is why some say it is a psalm of David, because it talks about those who hate him. David had many enemies. We've seen from the previous psalms that we've studied that David had many enemies. So there's an allusion here that this could be David writing. Verse 8. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in a man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. Now, in Hebrew thought, when you repeat stuff, this is a way of amplifying or emphasizing what you're trying to say. In Western thought, we tend to raise our voices, don't we? Or we tend to kind of like use words like very or extremely. Oh, yeah, it's extremely cold, or it's extremely heavy, or it's very hot today. But in Hebrew thought, you repeat stuff. You repeat it to emphasize it. This is why Jesus said, truly, truly, I say to you. Whenever you see Jesus saying, truly, truly, I say to you, what he's saying is, listen up, pay attention, underline this. This is important. You need to get this stuff right. That's what he's saying. So notice here, it's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. It's repeating the thing there in order to emphasize its importance. Remember in Jeremiah as well, it said about, cursed is the man who trusts in man. In Jeremiah 17, we saw this from Psalm 1, didn't we? Cursed is the man who trusts in man. He'll be like a shrub in the desert, in the wilderness. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. He will be like a tree planted by the water, who always bears fruit when there's a drought. Verse 10. All nations surrounded me, but in the name of the Lord, I will destroy them. They surrounded me. Yes, they surrounded me. But in the name of the Lord, I will destroy them. They surrounded me like bees. They were quenched like a fire of thorns. For in the name of the Lord, I will destroy them. See the repetition there once again. Now, bees or insects in the Bible have to do with the demonic. Bees or insects have to do with demons. This is what we see, for example, in Joel chapter 1. We've been studying the book of Joel recently, haven't we? And in Revelation chapter 5 as well, we see locusts. So locusts and bees and this kind of thing has to do with demonic things. Now, also, this has an end time meaning as well. Notice that it says, the nations surrounded me. Now, in Zechariah chapter 12, it tells us that the nations are going to surround Jerusalem. The nations are going to come against Jerusalem, and we see that fulfilled in Revelation 19. So again, there's always an end times aspect to take into account in a lot of these things. Verse 13, you pushed me violently that I might fall, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. What do you reckon the word there for salvation is in the Hebrew? Yeshua. Yes, what it means, Yeshua. The name Yeshua means God is salvation. So when people say the name Jesus isn't in the Old Testament, yes, it is, absolutely. Yeshua. God is my song and he has become my salvation. Hallelujah. Verse 15. The voice of rejoicing and salvation is in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. Once again, repetition that we see there. In other words, he's emphasizing its importance. Now, when you see God's right hand or the right hand of God, when you see the right hand in the Bible, this is another term for the Messiah. It's a biblical metaphor or term for the Messiah. For example, in Isaiah 41 verse 10, it says this, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." It's talking about the Messiah. The right hand of God is a metaphor or term for the Messiah. And where is Jesus sat right now? At the right hand of God the Father. Hallelujah. Verse 17, "I shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death." What does it say in Hebrews 12? It says that God disciplines those who he loves. If God is disciplining you, it's because he's treating you as one of his own. God will not discipline someone else's children. He will only discipline his own children, just as a good father would. "He has not given me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go through them, and I will praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous shall enter." Now, as I said, the East Gate is where these pilgrims would come and celebrate Jerusalem, celebrate these feasts when they arrive in Jerusalem. They'll enter through the East Gate. And it's the same gate that Jesus entered when he came to Jerusalem to present himself as the Messiah. The gate through which the righteous shall enter. Verse 21, "I will praise you, for you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes." Now, that's one of the most important verses right there in the Bible, in that it is quoted many times in the New Testament. "The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone." For example, it's quoted in the book of Acts in chapter 4, when Peter and John were arrested by the Sanhedrin. They quoted this verse saying, "This is the stone that the builders was rejected by you, sorry, the stone which was rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven among men by which we must be saved." In other words, this Jesus who you crucified, he has now become the head. He's now the chief cornerstone. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Now, in the Old Testament, or in the Bible altogether, to be honest, the stone is a picture, again, of the Messiah. Whenever you see a stone, it is typological of the Messiah. The ancient rabbis knew this based on Daniel chapter 2. Remember the image that Nebuchadnezzar, the image that he saw? It had all the different layers of metal and stuff, and this stone came and smashed it, didn't it? That statue represented the empires that will come and go throughout the centuries, and then the stone comes along and smashes that statue to pieces. That stone is the Messiah. The ancient rabbis understood what the stone meant in the Old Testament. And also in 1 Corinthians 10 and Luke 6, Jesus is called what? The rock. He's the rock, isn't he? And it's rock with capital R as well. If you read the text, it's rock with capital R. So just like any building, the temple, the Solomon's temple, was made up of many stones, which were all cut to precision. It's a wonderful feat of engineering how the temple was built. All these stones were cut absolutely to precision so that they fit nicely with each other. However, the first stone that was laid was the cornerstone. The cornerstone was always the first stone that was laid. And the purpose of the cornerstone is to make a perfect right angle. The perfect right angle, which all the other stones will then line up with. That is what the cornerstone is. It makes a perfect right angle for all the other stones in the building to line up with. Now, of course, you'd have to closely inspect a stone in order for it to be a worthy cornerstone. They would have vigorous, these builders and masons would have vigorous inspections to see whether a stone can be used as a cornerstone. And of course, there's a traditional story in Judaism that there was a stone which was inspected and they said, no, this is not good enough, but then was later on used as the cornerstone for the temple. So literally, the stone that was used for the cornerstone in the temple was initially rejected, but then was made the chief cornerstone. It's a story that most Jews of this time would have been very familiar with. And of course, there's another way to understand this, in that there is a final stone that goes on, the capstone. Now, the translation here of cornerstone is Rosh Pinah. Rosh Pinah. Rosh means head. So the capstone, the way to understand it is probably more in line with the capstone rather than the cornerstone. The capstone is the last stone that would go on the building. And the purpose of the capstone is to hold all the other stones in position. Again, any ancient builder will tell you this, that without the capstone, the whole thing will fall apart. Without the capstone, there's no structure, there's no support, there's no duration. The capstone would go on. And if it's all done correctly, these buildings would last for centuries. Again, it's a marvelous feat of engineering, how they was able to build these things with stones which weighed tons and have them last for centuries. There are still Roman structures throughout Western Europe and the Middle East. There are still Roman structures today that have been built and that you can still drive a car on. And then we go and build our roads here, and then 2 weeks later they're repairing the potholes, aren't they? Have you seen all the schools lately as well? All the schools and hospitals have now got to close because of this cheap concrete they've been using. Didn't even last 30 years. The Romans used to build these things with such a feat of engineering in that they lasted for centuries. And again, there are still Roman structures to this day that you can drive a car over that have been built to precision. So the last stone that goes on is the capstone. The first stone that is laid is the cornerstone. And of course, there's also a traditional story that there was a capstone that was initially sent when the temple was being built. They sent the capstone because the stones were cut away from the temple. You couldn't cut them on the site. They had to be cut in the quarry quite away from the temple. And they sent the capstone first. And the builders said, well, this stone doesn't clearly fit with this structure. So they chucked it in the Kidron Valley. Now, it tells us in 1 Kings 6:38 that it took 7 years to build the temple. In other words, this capstone sat in the Kidron Valley for 7 years. By then, it had moss and grass all growing around it. And then when it came for the capstone to be finally put in position, they said, well, we don't have it. It was already sent. And they didn't realize why there was no capstone, because they said, no, we already sent it. And then they said, hang on, that stone that we chucked 7 years ago in the Kidron Valley must be the one. So they had to haul it back up, this stone which weighs tons. They had to haul this stone back up, and that was the stone that was used. Again, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. All these stories were very well known in Judaism, particularly at the time of Jesus. They would have been stories that were very familiar with the people. But of course, the temple eventually was destroyed. Solomon's temple was destroyed in 586 BC by the Babylonians, which we studied quite recently. And then it was rebuilt under Ezra and Nehemiah, etc. And then that temple was then destroyed in 70 AD by the Romans. As a result of their rejection of Jesus, that temple was destroyed and burnt to the ground. And there hasn't been a temple standing in Jerusalem ever since. Which is why six times the New Testament calls the church the temple. So the church is now the temple where God dwells. He dwells in the church, i.e. in the hearts of you and I, by his Holy Spirit. We are the temple of God, the church. And of course, just like the physical temple that stood in Jerusalem, the spiritual church today also has a cornerstone, a capstone, and is made up of many stones, just like the ancient temple. It has a cornerstone, a capstone. Now, Jesus, of course, was inspected, wasn't he, by the Sanhedrin. He was inspected by Pilate. He was inspected by Herod as well, but he was rejected. He was rejected as the Messiah of Israel, hence why they nailed him to a cross. But then, hallelujah, he rose from the dead, didn't he? He rose from the dead, and now he's seated at the right hand of God the Father. In other words, that's a position of honor. God has made Jesus equal with himself by choosing him to sit at his right hand. So the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Jesus was inspected and he was rejected. And then he was exalted when he was raised from the dead. And this is why we read in Ephesians. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18, it says this. For through him we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. That's Jews and Gentiles, that is. We both have access by one Spirit to the Father, Christ our cornerstone. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. This is talking to Gentiles, don't forget. He's saying you were once strangers, but now you've been brought into the household of God. Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. Again, this is talking about the church, not the physical temple that stood in Jerusalem all those centuries ago, but this, the church, the spiritual temple that has now been built upon the foundation of Jesus Christ being the cornerstone, in whom you are also being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. In other words, it is through you and I who God lives by his Holy Spirit, the church. And then Ephesians 5 in verse 23 goes on to say, Christ is the head of the church. He's the cornerstone and the capstone. So Christ is the head of the church, not the Pope. You hear that, brothers and sisters? There is one head of the church. It's not the Pope. It's Jesus Christ. He's the head of the church. Whenever someone else claims to be the head of the church, this is blasphemous idolatry. Jesus Christ is the only head of the church. He's the cornerstone and the capstone. He's the first and the last. He's the first stone laid and the last stone laid. What does it say in Revelation 22, verse 13? I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Hebrews 12, verse 2, calls Jesus the author and finisher of our faith. In other words, he's the cornerstone and the capstone. He's what it's all built upon, and then he is him that holds the whole thing together. Without Jesus, the whole thing falls apart. Without Jesus, there is no church, there is no temple. Now, of course, Jesus was rejected and then exalted. And we see many times in the Bible that there's men of God who were once rejected but then exalted. Joseph, for example. Joseph was rejected by his brothers but then made Pharaoh's number two. Moses was initially rejected but then they called upon Moses to come and save them from Pharaoh. We saw in our series on the book of Judges, there's a guy called Jephthah in Judges 11 who was rejected by his brothers. His brothers drove him out because he was an illegitimate child. But then when the Ammonites invaded, they called for him to come and save them, didn't they? He was rejected and then exalted to a position of leadership. David was once rejected by his brothers, and then he was made the king of Israel. And we see also Mordecai in the book of Esther, who was told he was going to be hung for refusing to bow to Haman. But then Mordecai was what? Exalted to a position of honor. Whenever you see someone in the Bible, like Daniel, for example, who was rejected, put in the lion's den, but then exalted to a position of honor. Whenever you see this, this is to foreshadow Jesus, who was rejected and then exalted to a position of honor. He was rejected, nailed to a cross, but then he rose from the dead. And it doesn't just foreshadow Jesus as well, it foreshadows you and I. Because you and I are going to get persecuted in the last days. You and I are going to get condemned. And you and I are going to get rejected, but then we are going to reign with Christ in the kingdom of God as kings and priests. So whenever you see someone being rejected and made a position of honor, it is to foreshadow Jesus and also you and I. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Turn now to 1 Peter chapter 2. Keep your thumb on Psalm 118. We'll be going back to that and continuing, but for now, turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. Because as I said, the temple, the literal temple, had a cornerstone and a capstone. The spiritual temple, the church, has a cornerstone and a capstone. And both are made up of stones. In Matthew 3, verse 9, John the Baptist said to the Pharisees, do not think to you and say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. In other words, don't think just because you're a descendant of Abraham that all is going to be well. If God wants to, he'll raise up children for Abraham from these stones. And this also, which we see in 1 Peter 2, I believe is drawn from Matthew 16 when Jesus said to Peter, you are Peter, but upon this rock I will build my church. There's two Greek words used there. You are Petros, but on this Petra I will build my church. This is another reason why they get this so horribly wrong, calling the Pope the head of the church. They believe Peter was the first Pope. That's not what Jesus was saying at all. He said, you are Petros, and on this Petra, I will build my church. What's the difference? A Petros in Greek is a small stone. It's a small stone or a pebble. A Petra is what? A rock or a boulder. So in other words, you build upon a rock or a boulder as a firm foundation with small stones. That is how you build. You don't build upon a small stone with boulders. You build with small stones upon a boulder. That's what Jesus was saying to Peter. And it's in 1 Peter chapter 2 right here, I believe Peter is drawing that allusion from. 1 Peter chapter 2 in verse 4. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 4. Coming to him as to a living stone. A living stone, that is what he calls us, living stones. Rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God. Again, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. Precious is a term Peter uses quite a lot. You also, as living stones, are being built up to a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect. Notice Jesus is elect. The Calvinists get that one horribly wrong. Jesus is the one who is elect. Elect, precious, and he who believes in him will be by no means be put to shame. That's quoting Isaiah 28:16 right there. So even in Isaiah 28, we see that there is the cornerstone prophesied as the Messiah. Verse 7. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious, but to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. He's quoting Psalm 118, verse 22 right there. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Verse 8, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offence. Again, that's quoting Isaiah 8:14 right there. So what Peter is doing, he's actually taking many quotes from the Old Testament and he's putting these all together. Paul does this as well. They stumble being disobedient to the word to which they were also appointed. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Hallelujah. Who were once not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Hallelujah. What he's basically getting at here, to sum it up in a nutshell, he's saying, you're either going to know Jesus Christ as your Savior or as your judge. That's what he's basically getting at. You're either going to know him as your Savior or as your judge. And it's better to know him as our Savior, isn't it, brothers and sisters? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So he's saying that we are a temple built up of living stones. He calls us living stones, which are part of the temple, Jesus being the cornerstone, of course. Now, in Leviticus 14, there's various laws here. We won't go too deeply into this because there's so much you could talk about with these laws that we find in the book of Leviticus. But in Leviticus 14, from verse 33, there are rules and instructions concerning buildings which have contaminated stones. In other words, leprous, they are contaminated with plagues. Any builder or mason today will tell you that if a wall has mildew or mold, then the best thing to do is to take those bricks out and to replace them with fresh ones. Any builder or mason will tell you that. Isn't it funny how God knew this 2,500 years ago? And that if you have a building and have stones that are contaminated with a plague or leprosy, then you are to take those stones out. What does all that mean? It means that there are stones. What does leprosy mean in the Bible? What does leprosy represent in the Bible? Sin. Whenever you see leprosy, the man who was healed of his leprosy, whenever you see leprosy, this is a picture of sin. So in other words, those stones that are contaminated with leprosy, what's going to happen to them? They're going to get taken out. They're going to get taken out and replaced with those new ones. Romans 11 talks about being cut off from the olive tree and replaced with those branches from a wild tree. So those stones that are contaminated with the leprosy are going to get removed. There are stones out there who want the cornerstone to line up with them. They don't want to line up with the cornerstone. They want the cornerstone to line up with them. In other words, I don't agree with what this Bible says. I don't agree with what Paul says. They want the Bible to line up with them. They want to change the Bible to suit their opinions and their emotions and their feelings. They refuse to line up with the cornerstone. That is what the cornerstone is for. The stones are supposed to line up with the cornerstone. But there are stones out there that don't want to line up with the cornerstone. They want the cornerstone to line up with them. Well, Jesus said about these Laodicean lukewarm churches that he's going to vomit them out of his mouth. These lukewarm churches who refuse to preach the word of God are going to get vomited out of his mouth. And that's why the church is falling apart, isn't it? That's why the church is falling apart, not just in this country, but in the Western world. Because we've taken the capstone out. The capstone has been removed, and without the capstone, the whole thing falls apart. It has no duration. You need the capstone to hold together the rest of those stones that have been cut to perfection. Without the capstone, you've got nothing. And that's why the church is falling apart, because they want to take the capstone out. They have no room for the word of God in their church. They have no room for Jesus in their church. How many churches, not just in this area, but I'm sure everywhere, how many churches refuse to go out and preach the gospel? How many churches refuse to stand upon the word of Jesus Christ? That is why the church is fading in the Western world, because we've taken the capstone out and the whole thing falls apart. Let us go back to Psalm 118 and continue. We got up to verse 24. Psalm 118, verse 24. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Who's heard that before? Who starts their day by saying that? There's nothing wrong in doing so. I'm not saying you shouldn't do it. Just understand the context that it is talking about the day of the coming of the Messiah. That is what this is talking about. It's talking about the day of the coming of the Messiah, the day that Daniel predicted. Daniel, in chapter 9, predicted the very day that Jesus would present himself as the Messiah. And Jesus held them accountable in Luke 19. Jesus held them accountable for not recognizing the day of thy visitation, the day that the Lord came, the day that Jesus presented himself as the King. So this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Please do continue to start your day by reciting that verse. However, it is talking about the day of the coming of the Messiah. Verse 25. Save now, I pray, O Lord. Save now. What is the Hebrew there? Hoshiana. Hoshiana. Hosanna. Who's heard Hosanna before? That's what it literally means. Save now. Save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. Something we sing quite frequently here at CFM. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It's where it's taken from. Again, it's talking about the coming of the Messiah. Turn now to Matthew 21. There are a couple of verses left in Psalm 118, so just keep your thumb on it. But turn now to Matthew 21, because we're going to see now that this verse is once again quoted. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Matthew 21. Now, in Judaism, there was always two pictures of the coming of the Messiah. The ancient rabbis understood from the Old Testament there was two pictures of the coming of the Messiah. You have the Messiah coming as a suffering servant, and then you have the Messiah coming as a conquering king. They all understood these two aspects. The suffering servant is in the character of Joseph. Now, when I say Joseph, I don't mean his father. I mean Joseph from the book of Genesis, the suffering servant. That is one of the pictures of the Messiah in the Bible. The other one is the conquering king in the character, of course, of David. That's why the Messiah is called the Son of David. So there's two pictures of the Messiah there. The suffering servant in the character of Joseph and the conquering king in the character of David. And as I said, the ancient rabbis knew this, the rabbis before the time of Jesus, that is, because they knew from two different verses. For example, in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, as I've mentioned, it says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." That's one aspect of the coming of the Messiah. And the ancient rabbis knew that there was also the example of Daniel 7, verse 13, which is, "Behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven." You have two different pictures there of the coming of the Messiah. And there's a particular rabbi called Rabbi Yehoshua ben Levi who knew that there was two different pictures of the coming of the Messiah right there. And he writes about it. So the rabbis today who tell us that's a lie is not a lie whatsoever, because the ancient rabbis knew this. It's the rabbis today who are lying to us. And of course, as the servant, he comes on a donkey, because a donkey is like a servant picture. A donkey serves, doesn't it? A donkey labors. But then when he returns as the conquering king, what does he come on? Not a donkey, but a white horse. And a horse has to do with like a king, a conqueror. We see that in Revelation 19. So, of course, the ancient rabbis knew this, and we know this from the ancient Jewish scriptures. However, by the time of Jesus, they weren't interested in the suffering servant. They weren't interested in a Messiah who was going to come and die for their sin. They weren't interested in a Messiah who was going to come in the character of Joseph. They'd lost interest in that. One of the reasons for that is because of all the oppression that they'd lived under for so many centuries. By this time, the Romans were occupying Israel and Jerusalem, and they wanted to be free from their occupation. Hence why they were desperate for a conquering king to come and set them free. They weren't interested in a suffering servant. They wanted someone to come and set them free from the Romans. So that's what we must understand before we go into Matthew 21. In verse 1, now when they drew near Jerusalem, they came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives. This is just east of the Temple Mount. Then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you'll find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And immediately he will say to them, and all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. It's talking about Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. It's quoting that verse right there as a fulfillment of that prophecy. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and he set them on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Now, what time of year is this taking place? This is 5 days before Passover. What do we say at the beginning? The Hallel, this Psalm 118, is sung at Passover and Tabernacles. At Passover, it's sung with the hands in the air, and at Tabernacles, it's sung waving palm branches. It's Passover, 5 days before Passover, and yet we see that the people cut down branches from the trees. Why were they celebrating this feast as if it was the Feast of Tabernacles when it was Passover? Because they wanted the king to come and bring the kingdom of God. They wanted the Messiah to come and establish everlasting peace. They weren't interested in the sacrifice. They weren't interested in the suffering servant. They wanted peace and freedom now. So they began celebrating with palm branches. Who's heard of that term Palm Sunday, which is very much celebrated in the Western world, Palm Sunday? I dare you to go to your local Church of England and tell them that's a mistake. That Palm Sunday is based on a mistake which they made waving palm branches when they should have been waving their hands in the air, celebrating the coming of the Messiah, dying for their sin, not to overthrow the Romans, not to establish everlasting peace. Jesus said in Luke, I have not come to bring peace. I have not come to bring peace. I have come to bring division, division between father and son and mother and daughter. Jesus' purpose of his first coming was not to bring peace. It was to bring what? Atonement for sin for you and I. And for the Jews, ultimately. That is why he came. But they weren't interested in that. They wanted someone to overthrow the Romans. They wanted someone to set them free from their Roman oppressors and then to bring in everlasting righteousness, the kingdom of God. This is what the Messiah is supposed to do. He's supposed to bring in the kingdom of God on earth and establish the millennial reign. But he didn't do that. So they spread out on the road. They cut down the palm branches. Verse 9, then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Save now. Again, they're quoting Psalm 118 here. Hosanna to the Son of David. What should they have been saying? Hosanna to the Son of Joseph. He wasn't coming as David. He was coming as Joseph, the suffering servant. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, Hoshiana. That's what they were singing. And they were singing Psalm 118 because it's sung at Passover. Only they were waving palm branches instead. Again, the whole thing is a mistake on their part. Verse 10. And when he had come to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? So the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. So again, they thought he was going to come in and get rid of the Romans. This is what they thought he was coming to do. This is why they were happy to sing, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, as you enter the east gate, you have on the right-hand side, you had the temple, but then you had the fortress of Antonio, which was the Roman occupation. It was the Roman military headquarters. They thought he was going to enter, turn right, and get rid of the Romans. What does he do instead? Verse 12. Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple, and overturned the tables of the money changers and at the seats of those who sold doves. So he hasn't gone in and got rid of the Romans like they thought he was going to. He's gone in and instead he's got rid of Joel Osteen and Kenneth Copeland. Hallelujah. That's what he did. He drove out the money changers, those who were selling in Solomon's porch. Now, Solomon's porch was to the left. So that he didn't make a right, he made a left. And he got rid of those who were financially corrupt, saying, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. Why were they indignant? Because they're singing the song about the coming of the Messiah. They were singing the song about the coming of the Messiah, saying that Jesus is the Messiah, when they didn't want him to be the Messiah. And said to him, do you hear what these are saying? And Jesus said to them, yes, have you never read, out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise. So again, they were desperate for the millennial reign to begin. They were desperate for peace to come. They were desperate for Jesus to get rid of the Romans, but he didn't. And that's why he was rejected. They wanted the peace. They wanted the prosperity. They wanted it now. And this is why they rejected him. He didn't bring them what they wanted. That's why. Christ does not give us what we want. He gives us what we need. He will never give us what we want. He gives us what we need. What they wanted was peace and prosperity. What they needed was atonement for sin. And that's why he came. He came to bring atonement for sin. They weren't interested in the sacrifice. And it's because of this way of thinking that we have this same nonsense today. It's because of this kingdom now theology. It's because of this dominion theology, which basically says that Christians must take over the world in order for Christ to return. It's basically the Christian version of jihad. Christians must take over the world and bring in righteousness for Christ to return. No, Christ will bring righteousness when he returns. It's because of this kingdom now theology that people are also not interested in the sacrifice. They don't recognize the need for atonement for sin. They don't recognize the need to live a crucified life. Philippians 3:18 calls them enemies of the cross of Christ, those who set their mind on earthly things. They don't want to live a crucified life. They don't want to crucify the flesh. They don't want to pick up their cross, deny themselves and follow Christ because they're set on earthly things. They want kingdom now. They want peace and prosperity now. And that's, again, a problem in the church today, just as it was in this time. Satan used this to deceive the Jews, and now he's using it to deceive the church. They're not interested in the sacrifice. They're interested in peace and prosperity. That's all we hear from these prosperity preachers, isn't it? Prosperity. God's going to make you rich. God's going to bless you with a Mercedes-Benz. He's not going to bless you with a Mercedes-Benz because the Bible says blessing comes from wisdom. That's what God's going to bless you with. He's going to bless you with wisdom. Hallelujah. So again, still to this day, people are looking for someone who's going to give them what they want. Not what they need. They want someone who's going to give them what they want. Peace and prosperity. And that's why they're going to reject Jesus and accept another, the Antichrist, who is going to bring peace and prosperity. The Antichrist is going to bring peace and prosperity, but it's a peace without God. It's a peace which isn't going to last. It's a peace which he himself is going to break. So people always cry out, we want peace. All this socialist agenda is always about peace. We want world peace. How dare you speak against such a man of peace? They want peace, but they don't want the Prince of Peace, do they? You can't have peace without the Prince of Peace. They want peace, but they're not interested in the Prince of Peace, are they? And that's exactly why the Jews are going to accept the Antichrist immediately, because he's going to deceive them into thinking he's the Messiah. What does he come on? A white horse. In Revelation 6, he comes on a white horse. He's a counterfeit of Christ. Christ comes on a white horse, but then before that, you have the Antichrist coming on a white horse to deceive the world into believing that he's the Messiah. It's only 3.5 years into that covenant that he revealed his true colors. But they're going to accept him. Jesus alluded to this. He said, I come in my Father's name, but and you don't receive me. But if one comes in another name, him you'll receive. That's a little hint there about the Antichrist. They're going to accept this Antichrist as the Messiah. Even though he can't fulfill any of the messianic criteria in the Bible, they're going to accept him. Why? Because he's going to bring peace. And that's all they're interested in, peace and prosperity. Only it's a peace that will not last because it is a peace that is without God. It's a peace that is not founded upon the Prince of Peace. Again, Jesus did not come to give them what they want. He came to give them what they need, which was atonement for sin. Let's continue in Matthew 21 from verse 33. We're going to see a parable here. A parable which they knew was about them. Matthew 21 verse 33. Hear another parable. There was a certain landowner who planted a vineyard and set a hedge around it, dug a winepress in it and built a tower, and he leased it to vine dressers and went into a far country. Now, who do you think that vineyard is? That's talking about Israel. From Isaiah 5, the vineyard always represents Israel. And Jesus would have known that the Pharisees would have understood that the vineyard is talking about Israel. Now, when vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the vine dressers that they might receive its fruit. And the vine dressers took his servants, beat one, killed one, and stoned another. Who are the servants there? They're the prophets. God sent prophets to warn Israel about their sin. God sent prophets to tell Israel to repent. And what did they do? They killed many of them. Isaiah, Zechariah, they were all killed, weren't they? Or beaten. Jeremiah was put into a cistern, wasn't he? And again, he sent other servants, more than the first. And they did likewise to them. Again, he kept sending prophets. He kept sending warning. God will never send judgment without sending warning first. Verse 37. Then last of all, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. So now it's not just the prophets who God is sending, it's his own son. He's going to send his own son now. But when the vine dressers saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and seize his inheritance. What did they do? They nailed him to a cross, didn't they? So they took him and cast him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those vine dressers? They, the Pharisees, said to him, he will destroy those wicked men miserably and lease his vineyard to other vine dressers who will render to him the fruits in their season. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone? He's quoting Psalm 118 right there against them. This is the Lord's doing and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation bearing the fruits of it. Again, it was not, the kingdom of God was intended for Israel, but Israel rejected their Messiah, and that's why the gospel went to who? The Gentiles, the Gentile nations. That's why Great Britain and America historically are the greatest Christian nations of all time. Therefore, I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation bearing the fruits of it. And whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but on whoever it falls, it will grind him to powder. Now, that's pretty much saying the same sort of thing that Peter alluded to in chapter 2. You're either going to meet Jesus as your savior or as your judge. Verse 45. Now, when the chief priests and Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking of them. But when they sought to lay hands on him, they feared the multitudes because they took him for a prophet. So he knew he was telling this parable against them. They knew that the vineyard, according to Isaiah chapter 5, is talking about Israel. And he knew that they were telling the parable against them. Let us go back now to Psalm 118 and finish the last couple of verses. We go up to verse 27. Psalm 118, verse 27. God is the Lord, and he has given us light. How has God given us light? Because Jesus came into the world, who is the light of the world. Jesus called himself the light of the world, and he has given us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. Again, what was Jesus coming as? A conquering king? No, not yet. He came as a sacrifice. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. The altar had horns on its corner, like little pointy objects on the corner. The altar of sacrifice and the altar of incense as well was the same. You are my God and I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. See there how it begins and ends in the same way. His mercy endures forever. The psalm begins and ends in the same way. So again, one of the reasons that Jews still to this day reject Jesus as a Messiah is because he didn't bring the peace that they thought he would. The Old Testament speaks about a Messiah who will bring in peace, the kingdom of God that will last forever. But he didn't fulfill those messianic prophecies. He fulfilled the prophecies concerning the suffering servant, the sacrifice for sin. But we know that he will return to fulfill those prophecies. He will return not as a lamb this time, but as a lion. He will return not as a servant, but as a king. And he will not come on a donkey this time. He will come on a white horse. He will come to fulfill those prophecies and to bring in everlasting righteousness, everlasting peace, and to destroy Israel's enemies. Now he will return, according to Hosea 5:15, he will return when Israel repents. Hosea 5:15, I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their offense. Then they will seek my face. In their affliction, they will earnestly seek me. In other words, when Israel acknowledges that they have rejected their own Messiah, when they repent of their offense, it's offense singular, they don't forget, not offenses, it's offense singular. When Israel repents of their rejection, that is when Jesus will return. And that's what he alludes to in Matthew 23. In Matthew 23, he's entered Jerusalem now, he's drove out the money changers, he's had many discussions with the religious leaders. And in Matthew 23, verse 37, he weeps over Jerusalem. He says, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. So he's talking to Jerusalem now like a person. He's personifying Jerusalem. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. It's not Christ who wasn't willing. It was Jerusalem who wasn't willing. When someone is destroyed, it's not because Christ wasn't willing. It's because they weren't willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more until you say, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In other words, you will not see me again until you repent. You will not see me again until you acknowledge me as your Messiah. That is what Jesus is saying right here in Matthew 23. And again, he's quoting Psalm 118, verse 22. So in other words, Jesus is going to return. He's going to come through the east gate once again, and he's going to drive out the money changers once again. We see right now these churches, these lukewarm Laodicean churches, are already being exposed and being destroyed. You've been in some of these lukewarm churches lately? They're empty. They're absolutely empty. Why? Because God is doing away with them. Jesus said, when the salt stops doing its job, what do with it? You throw it away. You can't make it new again. You have to get rid of it. And that's what's happening right now. Jesus is getting rid of those money changers. He's going to come back. He's going to get rid of Joel Osteen. He's going to get rid of Benny Hinn. He's going to get rid of Joyce Meyer. He's going to get rid of these prosperity preachers. And he's already doing so. I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth, Jesus said, Revelation 3. But then he's going to go a step further and he's going to get rid of the corrupt political establishment. He's going to get rid of Israel's enemies. He's going to get rid of Joe Biden. He's going to get rid of Justin Trudeau. He's going to get rid of Sadiq Khan. Boy, I can't wait for that one, man. There's some pretty disgruntled Londoners right now, isn't there? You won't get your £12.50 back, unfortunately, but he is going to be destroyed. And I hope he repents before he is, because Jesus is coming back to get rid of the corrupt political establishment. And then, according to Revelation 17 and 19, or 18 as well, Babylon is going to be destroyed. Religious Babylon and political Babylon. Now Jude 1:14 says this, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints. In other words, he isn't returning alone, he's returning with who? You and I. He's going to return with you and I to bring in everlasting righteousness. And this is what we see in Revelation. Remember in Matthew 21, he came and they were waving palm branches, weren't they? They shouldn't have been, because it wasn't the Feast of Tabernacles. It was the Feast of Passover. But in Revelation 7, verse 9, we see this. A multitude has been raptured. This is the multitude has been raptured and ready to return with Christ. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. After these things, I looked and behold, a great multitude, which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne, before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands. They were holding palm branches. Why? Because they're getting ready to return with Christ. So there will be palm branches when Jesus returns, and there will be palm branches for the right reasons, because the Feast of Tabernacles will be fulfilled when Jesus returns to reign with the saints. We're all going to have palm branches, and we're all going to come with Christ to usher in the kingdom of God. And we are going to reign with him. He's going to destroy Israel's enemies. He's going to destroy the political religious establishment. And then he's going to bring in everlasting righteousness. And then Israel will once again sing, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, when we return with the Lord. He's going to bring in everlasting peace, everlasting righteousness, and we will reign with him as kings and priests. That's the inheritance that awaits you and I. If you're poor, don't think you're poor, because you're not, because you have an inheritance awaiting you in the kingdom of God, in that you are going to reign with Jesus Christ as a king and priest. Hallelujah. However, that is only for those who know Christ. That is only for those who belong to Jesus Christ. That inheritance is only found in Jesus Christ. Outside of Jesus Christ, there's no inheritance. Jesus said the only inheritance you're going to get is out of darkness and weeping and gnashing of teeth. That's the only inheritance that awaits those who do not belong to Jesus Christ. But if you belong to Jesus Christ, if you are one of his, then get the palm branches ready because you're going to reign with him in the kingdom of God as kings and priests. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Let us give thanks in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much for this day. And yes, we will say, Lord, this is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. But we thank you, Lord, that there is a greater day coming. We thank you, Lord, that the day is coming where our Saviour, our Messiah, our King is returning to reign on David's throne. And we thank you that we get to reign with him. Even though we are so unworthy, we are so undeserving of the inheritance that awaits us. We thank you, Lord, that by your grace and by your mercy, you have appointed us to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled in the kingdom of God. And we thank you, Lord, that you've given this as a free gift of your grace. And Lord, we just praise you and thank you that that was only made possible because of the sacrifice of your dear son. That was only made possible because of his shed blood for our sin. And we thank you for the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We thank you that our sin has been removed. We thank you that we are now right with you. We thank you that we can now come boldly to the throne of grace. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, that we can call you our Father and that you call us your children. Thank you that we are children of the Most High God. We thank you, Heavenly Father. And we thank you, Lord, that this is a gift that we've received. We thank you, Lord, that it's by faith alone. We thank you, Lord, that works can never please you because we could never please you with our works. Our works are like filthy rags to you, Lord. But we thank you that by grace through faith, we have been adopted into the kingdom of God and that we have that inheritance awaiting us in the kingdom. We give you praise and thanks, Lord. We give you praise and thanks for this word, for the book of Psalms. And we thank you, Lord, for all the lessons we've learned in that, Lord. We thank you for the Holy Spirit living in each of us that leads us into all truth. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for our Saviour, our coming King, who shed his blood on the cross and who's returning to reign in the kingdom of God to bring in everlasting peace and everlasting righteousness. And that sin will be a thing of the past that we won't even remember. We praise you and thank you for Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord and Saviour, in whose name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.